This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Story: My Life, the Story of a Provincial. Topic 1. The superintendent said to me, "I only keep you out of regard for your worthy father, but for that you would have been sent flying long ago." I replied to him, "You flatter me too much, Your Excellency, in assuming that I am capable of flying." And then I heard him say, "Take that gentleman away, he gets upon my nerves." 2 days later, I was dismissed. And in this way, I have, during the years I have been regarded as grown up, lost 9 situations, to the great mortification of my father, the architect of our town. I have served in various departments, but all these 9 jobs have been as alike as one drop of water is to another. I had to sit, write, listen to rude or stupid observations, and go on doing so till I was dismissed. When I came in to my father, he was sitting buried in a low armchair with his eyes closed. His dry, emaciated face with a shade of dark blue where it was shaved, he looked like an old Catholic organist, expressed meekness and resignation. Without responding to my greeting or opening his eyes, he said, "If my dear wife and your mother were living, your life would have been a source of continual distress to her. I see the divine providence in her premature death. I beg you, unhappy boy," he continued, opening his eyes, "tell me, what am I to do with you? In the past, when I was younger, my friends and relations had known what to do with me. Some of them used to advise me to volunteer for the army, others to get a job in a pharmacy, and others in the telegraph department. Now that I am over 25, that gray hairs are beginning to show on my temples, and that I have been already in the army and in a pharmacy and in the telegraph department, it would seem that all earthly possibilities have been exhausted, and people have given up advising me, and merely sigh or shake their heads. What do you think about yourself?" my father went on. "By the time they are your age, young men have a secure social position, while look at you. You are a proletarian, a beggar, a burden on your father." And as usual, he proceeded to declare that the young people of today were on the road to perdition through infidelity, materialism, and self-conceit, and that amateur theatricals ought to be prohibited because they seduced young people from religion and their duties. "Tomorrow we shall go together, and you shall apologize to the superintendent and promise him to work conscientiously," he said in conclusion. "You ought not to remain one single day with no regular position in society." "I beg you to listen to me," I said sullenly, expecting nothing good from this conversation. "What you call a position in society is the privilege of capital and education. Those who have neither wealth nor education earn their daily bread by manual labor, and I see no grounds for my being an exception. When you begin talking about manual labor, it is always stupid and vulgar," said my father with irritation. "Understand, you dense fellow, understand, you addlepate, that besides coarse physical strength you have the divine spirit, a spark of the holy fire, which distinguishes you in the most striking way from the ass or the reptile, and brings you nearer to the deity. This fire is the fruit of the efforts of the best of mankind, during thousands of years. Your great-grandfather Polosnev, the general, fought at Borodino. Your grandfather was a poet, an orator, and a marshal of nobility. Your uncle is a schoolmaster. And lastly, I, your father, am an architect. All the Polosnevs have guarded the sacred fire for you to put it out." "One must be just," I said. "Millions of people put up with manual labor. And let them put up with it. They don't know how to do anything else. Anybody, even the most abject fool or criminal, is capable of manual labor. Such labor is the distinguishing mark of the slave and the barbarian, while the holy fire is vouchsafed only to a few." To continue this conversation was unprofitable. My father worshipped himself, and nothing was convincing to him but what he said himself. Besides, I knew perfectly well that the disdain with which he talked of physical toil was founded not so much on reverence for the sacred fire as on a secret dread that I should become a workman and should set the whole town talking about me. What was worse, all my contemporaries had long ago taken their degrees and were getting on well, and the son of the manager of the state bank was already a collegiate assessor, while I, his only son, was nothing. To continue the conversation was unprofitable and unpleasant, but I still sat on and feebly retorted, hoping that I might at last be understood. The whole question, of course, was clear and simple, and only concerned with the means of my earning my living, but the simplicity of it was not seen, and I was talked to in mawkishly rounded phrases of Borodino, of the sacred fire, of my uncle, a forgotten poet, who had once written poor and artificial verses. I was rudely called an addlepate and a dense fellow. And how I longed to be understood. In spite of everything, I loved my father and my sister, and it had been my habit from childhood to consult them, a habit so deeply rooted that I doubt whether I could ever have got rid of it, whether I were in the right or the wrong. I was in constant dread of wounding them, constantly afraid that my father's thin neck would turn crimson and that he would have a stroke. To sit in a stuffy room, I began, to copy, to compete with a typewriter, is shameful and humiliating for a man of my age. What can the sacred fire have to do with it? It's intellectual work anyway, said my father. But that's enough, let us cut short this conversation, and in any case I warn you, if you don't go back to your work again, but follow your contemptible propensities, then my daughter and I will banish you from our hearts. I shall strike you out of my will, I swear by the living God. With perfect sincerity to prove the purity of the motives by which I wanted to be guided in all my doings, I said, the question of inheritance does not seem very important to me. I shall renounce it all beforehand. For some reason or other, quite to my surprise, these words were deeply resented by my father. He turned crimson. Don't dare to talk to me like that, stupid, he shouted in a thin, shrill voice. Wastrel, and with a rapid, skillful, and habitual movement he slapped me twice in the face. You are forgetting yourself. When my father beat me as a child I had to stand up straight, with my hands held stiffly to my trouser seams, and look him straight in the face. And now when he hit me I was utterly overwhelmed, and, as though I were still a child, drew myself up and tried to look him in the face. My father was old and very thin, but his delicate muscles must have been as strong as leather, for his blows hurt a good deal. I staggered back into the passage, and there he snatched up his umbrella, and with it hit me several times on the head and shoulders. At that moment my sister opened the drawing-room door to find out what the noise was, but at once turned away with a look of horror and pity without uttering a word in my defense. My determination not to return to the government office, but to begin a new life of toil, was not to be shaken. All that was left for me to do was to fix upon the special employment, and there was no particular difficulty about that, as it seemed to me that I was very strong and fitted for the very heaviest labor. I was faced with a monotonous life of toil, in the midst of hunger, coarseness, and stench, continually preoccupied with earning my daily bread. And who knows? As I returned from my work along Great Dvoryansky Street, I might very likely envy Dolzhikov, the engineer, who lived by intellectual work, but at the moment, thinking over all my future hardships made me lighthearted. At times I had dreamed of spiritual activity, imagining myself a teacher, a doctor, or a writer, but these dreams remained dreams. The taste for intellectual pleasures, for the theater for instance, and for reading, was a passion with me. But whether I had any ability for intellectual work, I don't know. At school I had had an unconquerable aversion for Greek, so that I was only in the fourth class when they had to take me from school. For a long while I had coaches preparing me for the fifth class. Then I served in various government offices, spending the greater part of the day in complete idleness, and I was told that was intellectual work. My activity in the scholastic and official sphere had required neither mental application, nor talent, nor special qualifications, nor creative impulse. It was mechanical. Such intellectual work I put on a lower level than physical toil. I despise it, and I don't think that for one moment it could serve as a justification for an idle, careless life, as it is indeed nothing but a sham, one of the forms of that same idleness. Real intellectual work, I have in all probability never known. Evening came on. We lived in Great Dvoryansky Street. It was the principal street in the town, and in the absence of decent public gardens, our beau monde used to use it as a promenade in the evenings. This charming street did to some extent take the place of a public garden, as on each side of it there was a row of poplars which smelt sweet, particularly after rain, and acacias, tall bushes of lilac, wild cherries and apple trees hung over the fences and palings. The May twilight, the tender young greenery with its shifting shades, the scent of the lilac, the buzzing of the insects, the stillness, the warmth. How fresh and marvelous it all is, though spring is repeated every year. I stood at the garden gate and watched the passers-by. With most of them, I had grown up and at one time played pranks. Now they might have been disconcerted by my being near them, for I was poorly and unfashionably dressed, and they used to say of my very narrow trousers and huge, clumsy boots that they were like sticks of macaroni stuck in boats. Besides, I had a bad reputation in the town because I had no decent social position, and used often to play billiards in cheap taverns, and also, perhaps, because I had on two occasions been hauled up before an officer of the police, though I had done nothing whatever to account for this. In the big house opposite, someone was playing the piano at Dolzhikov's. It was beginning to get dark, and stars were twinkling in the sky. Here my father, in an old top hat with wide upturned brim, walked slowly by with my sister on his arm, bowing in response to greetings. "Look up," he said to my sister, pointing to the sky with the same umbrella with which he had beaten me that afternoon. "Look up at the sky. Even the tiniest stars are all worlds. How insignificant is man, in comparison with the universe." And he said this in a tone that suggested that it was particularly agreeable and flattering to him that he was so insignificant. How absolutely devoid of talent and imagination he was. Sad to say, he was the only architect in the town, and in the 15 to 20 years that I could remember, not one single decent house had been built in it. When anyone asked him to plan a house, he usually drew first the reception hall and drawing room, just as in old days the boarding school misses always started from the stove when they danced, so his artistic ideas could only begin and develop from the hall and drawing room. To them he tacked on a dining room, a nursery, a study, linking the rooms together with doors, and so they all inevitably turned into passages, and every one of them had two or even three unnecessary doors. His imagination must have been lacking in clearness, extremely muddled, curtailed. As though feeling that something was lacking, he invariably had recourse to all sorts of outbuildings, planting one beside another, and I can see now the narrow entries, the pokey little passages, the crooked staircases leading to half-landings where one could not stand upright, and where, instead of a floor, there were three huge steps like the shelves of a bathhouse, and the kitchen was invariably in the basement with a brick floor and vaulted ceilings. The front of the house had a harsh, stubborn expression, the lines of it were stiff and timid, the roof was low-pitched and, as it were, squashed down, and the fat, well-fed-looking chimneys were invariably crowned by wire caps with squeaking black cowls. And for some reason all these houses built by my father exactly like one another, vaguely reminded me of his top hat and the back of his head, stiff and stubborn looking. In the course of years, they have grown used in the town to the poverty of my father's imagination. It has taken root and become our local style. This same style my father had brought into my sister's life also, beginning with christening her Cleopatra, just as he had named me Missale. When she was a little girl, he scared her by references to the stars, to the sages of ancient times, to our ancestors, and discoursed at length on the nature of life and duty. And now, when she was 26, he kept up the same habits, allowing her to walk arm in arm with no one but himself, and imagining for some reason that sooner or later a suitable young man would be sure to appear, and to desire to enter into matrimony with her from respect for his personal qualities. She adored my father, feared him, and believed in his exceptional intelligence. It was quite dark, and gradually the street grew empty. The music had ceased in the house opposite, the gate was thrown wide open, and a team with three horses trotted frolicking along our street with a soft tinkle of little bells. That was the engineer going for a drive with his daughter. It was bedtime. I had my own room in the house, but I lived in a shed in the yard, under the same roof as a brick barn, which had been built some time or other, probably to keep harness in. Great hooks were driven into the wall. Now it was not wanted, and for the last 30 years my father had stowed away in it his newspapers, which for some reason he had bound in half-yearly volumes and allowed nobody to touch. Living here, I was less liable to be seen by my father and his visitors, and I fancied that if I did not live in a real room and did not go into the house every day to dinner, my father's words that I was a burden upon him did not sound so offensive. My sister was waiting for me. Unseen by my father, she had brought me some supper, not a very large slice of cold veal and a piece of bread. In our house, such sayings as, "A penny saved is a penny gained," and "Take care of the pence and the pounds will take care of themselves," and so on were frequently repeated, and my sister, weighed down by these vulgar maxims, did her utmost to cut down the expenses, and so we fared badly. Putting the plate on the table, she sat down on my bed and began to cry. "Missel," she said, "what a way to treat us!" She did not cover her face. Her tears dropped on her bosom and hands, and there was a look of distress on her face. She fell back on the pillow and abandoned herself to her tears, sobbing and quivering all over. "You have left the service again," she articulated. "Oh, how awful it is! But do understand, sister, do understand," I said, and I was overcome with despair because she was crying. As ill luck would have it, the kerosene in my little lamp was exhausted, it began to smoke, and was on the point of going out, and the old hooks on the walls looked down sullenly, and their shadows flickered. "Have mercy on us," said my sister, sitting up. "Father is in terrible distress and I am ill. I shall go out of my mind." "What will become of you?" she said, sobbing and stretching out her arms to me. "I beg you, I implore you, for our dear mother's sake, I beg you to go back to the office." "I can't, Cleopatra," I said, feeling that a little more and I should give way. "I cannot." "Why not?" my sister went on. "Why not? Well, if you can't get on with the head, look out for another post. Why shouldn't you get a situation on the railway, for instance? I have just been talking to Anyuta Blagovo. She declares they would take you on the railway line and even promised to try and get a post for you. For God's sake, Miss Ale, think a little. Think a little, I implore you." We talked a little longer, and I gave way. I said that the thought of a job on the railway that was being constructed had never occurred to me, and that if she liked, I was ready to try it. She smiled joyfully through her tears and squeezed my hand, and then went on crying, because she could not stop, while I went to the kitchen for some kerosene. Topic 2. Among the devoted supporters of amateur theatricals, concerts and tableaux vivants for charitable objects, the Azhagans, who lived in their own house in Great Dvoryansky Street, took a foremost place. They always provided the room, and took upon themselves all the troublesome arrangements and the expenses. They were a family of wealthy landowners, who had an estate of some 9,000 acres in the district and a capital house, but they did not care for the country, and lived winter and summer alike in the town. The family consisted of the mother, a tall, spare, refined lady with short hair, a short jacket, and a flat-looking skirt in the English fashion, and three daughters who, when they were spoken of, were called not by their names but simply, the eldest, the middle, and the youngest. They all had ugly sharp chins, and were short-sighted and round-shouldered. They were dressed like their mother, they lisped disagreeably, and yet in spite of that, infallibly took part in every performance and were continually doing something with a charitable object, acting, reciting, singing. They were very serious and never smiled, and even in a musical comedy they played without the faintest trace of gaiety, with a businesslike air, as though they were engaged in bookkeeping. I loved our theatricals, especially the numerous, noisy, and rather incoherent rehearsals, after which they always gave a supper. In the choice of the plays and the distribution of the parts, one had no hand at all. The post assigned to me lay behind the scenes. I painted the scenes, copied out the parts, prompted, made up the actors' faces, and I was entrusted too with various stage effects such as thunder, the singing of nightingales, and so on. Since I had no proper social position and no decent clothes, at the rehearsals I held aloof from the rest in the shadows of the wings and maintained a shy silence. I painted the scenes at the Azhagans, either in the barn or in the yard. I was assisted by Andrei Ivanov, a house painter, or as he called himself, a contractor for all kinds of house decorations, a tall, very thin, pale man of 50, with a hollow chest with sunken temples with blue rings round his eyes, rather terrible to look at, in fact. He was afflicted with some internal malady, and every autumn and spring, people said that he wouldn't recover. But after being laid up for a while, he would get up and say afterwards with surprise, "I have escaped dying again." In the town he was called Radish, and they declared that this was his real name. He was as fond of the theater as I was, and as soon as rumors reached him that a performance was being got up, he threw aside all his work and went to the Azhagans to paint scenes. The day after my talk with my sister, I was working at the Azhagans from morning till night. The rehearsal was fixed for 7 o'clock in the evening, and an hour before it began, all the amateurs were gathered together in the hall, and the eldest, the middle, and the youngest Azhagans were pacing about the stage, reading from manuscript books. Radish, in a long rusty red overcoat and a scarf muffled round his neck, already stood leaning with his head against the wall, gazing with a devout expression at the stage. Madam Azhagan went up first to one, and then to another guest, saying something agreeable to each. She had a way of gazing into one's face, and speaking softly as though telling a secret. It must be difficult.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.